basically a consistent shithole, literally. Hey guys, it's Alyssa and welcome back to my channel. Today I am talking about something a little different. I'm talking about fostering animals. I feel like over the time frame of me and my family fostering animals, I've gotten a decent amount of questions, whether that's questions about fostering animals or even just questions about the adoption process, etc. So I kind of felt like I wanted to just talk about it and tell you things that, you know, things to know, answer these questions, or even as well as more so things I wish I knew before doing it, just a lump sum of things, as well as even if you're, you know, not a person who ever had these questions, maybe this will give some insight and maybe you will adopt or foster. We always need fosters all of the time, as well as, you know, obviously adopt, don't shop. So with that being said, I will jump in. Technically, my mom is the like name under the foster rescue, if that makes sense. Like, she's the one in the Facebook group chat who sees all of the animals that need, you know, like rescuing and everything. Obviously I live here, so I'm a very big part of it. I'm basically the one who, like, if my mom wants to foster, she asks me first. Like, she never just picks up an animal because I'm the one who's home most of the day doing whatever I need to do for them during the day. So I'm a big part of it, as well as I also, like, you know, my mom lets me go through the applications, and obviously the rescue knows who I am, etc., etc. So we go through a Rejoiceful Animal Rescue located here in Clinton Township, Michigan. They are obviously a nonprofit, like us all, and they go based off donations. So obviously if you would like to donate, that'd be fantastic. We personally only foster puppies. We have our first kitten right now, but we have only fostered puppies. We do not foster older dogs. We haven't fostered like a grown cat either. We could, but probably not. And that is just because of our animals here. My dogs don't really get along with other random dogs. It would just be way too chaotic and probably dangerous. So we stick to puppies, and now apparently kittens. We have a kitten right now. I will insert a picture of her. Her name is Moxie. And yeah, we've been fostering for, I don't know, definitely a year, probably longer, year and a half. I don't know. It's been a minute. So the first thing I want to say about fostering, it's difficult, and I'm sure like everybody knows that, but it's not sunshines and rainbows. And a lot of people think like, oh my God, how fun, like you get to foster and like have these cute little puppies running around or whatever. And don't get me wrong, there are a lot of bright sides. It's not sunshine and rainbows. I'm also a very, like, I get very stressed out very easily. And one of the things with fostering puppies, especially the ones that we usually get, so a lot of the time these puppies are not 8 weeks old. I don't think I've had an 8 week old foster puppy ever. They always come younger because, you know, they're either found that way or, you know, the mom gives birth and something happened, whatever the situation is, they're never like full puppies. When they're young, they are preferred to go in pairs unless like they absolutely cannot find anybody to take them in pairs. So having two puppies at once is a bit difficult. There's pros and cons to each. We've obviously had puppies that came in pairs, and we've had puppies that are just, they were singular on their own. The thing about fostering puppies is they're like babies. They are on a schedule, or should I say lack of schedule. So for example, when we have like young puppies, it's so chaotic in this house because somebody is always on puppy duty. And basically like the routine is my mom would wake up in the morning for work, and she does her thing of feeding them, whatever, picking up their poop, everything. And the thing with puppies is, like I said, like babies, they just literally shit everywhere. They shit and piss everywhere, and then they step in it. It's basically a consistent shithole, literally. and then she goes to work, and when I wake up like a couple hours later or whatever, the process continues and I take care of them throughout the day. And then kind of once my stepdad or my mom gets home, I tap out and they tap back in. And then depending on, you know, the puppy and the situation, a lot of the times my mom will have to like stay up with them at night. Or like there's been times where she's slept on the couch near their cage that we would have for them because they wake up continuously. With kittens, not that I've had a kitten this small, I've done it at the rescue place, but I have not had it in my home, is when kittens are really young, they do not know how to go to the bathroom by themselves. You have to like stimulate them. So that's fun. it's just basically, I could go on and on about all of the, I don't wanna say cons, but negatives and cons to fostering and just like the stress of it. There's been many mornings that I've been crying. And again, that's also just because I get very stressed, but like it's a stressful time sometimes. So I just want to say it's not easy. It's quite difficult in that regard. Another thing to know is when fostering, it's obviously hard to give them away. I'm going to sound like such an ass, but I don't have too much of a problem with this as much as my mom does. And I think that's partly because I get so stressed. So kind of when it's like time to give them away, I'm almost like, oh, thank God. Like I need a break. You know what I mean? And like, I do get sad. Don't get me wrong. But not sad enough to keep them, I should say. For example, one of the pairs of puppies we had, one of the puppies went to a family that we know very personally, like they are our friends. So we do get to see that dog a lot now that it's grown up, and that is super cool. And there's the other puppy of that litter that we gave away. You know, we don't know them, but we were getting, you know, updates initially. I think my mom still gets updates every once in a while, like a picture of them. And you know, it's really cool to see them grow up. I will say I'm never the one that has given them away, so I'm sure it'd be different. Like my mom is the one that meets the family and physically gives said puppy away, so I'm sure it's a lot more difficult doing that than me saying goodbye to them at home and then just staying at home and not seeing them physically being taken away. Oh, someone just has to do their freaking lawn right now. Okay, well, you're just gonna have to hear it in the background. I'd wait, but my battery's kind of dying, so I can't take forever. Sorry. So if you are looking to foster, some things that I would like to mention is a lot of people think that unless you're home all day, you can't foster. That is not true. Obviously, is it preferred if you can be home with said animal all day, every day? Yes, but like that's not realistic, obviously. You totally do not have to be home all day. This obviously depends on what and who you're fostering. Obviously for like little puppies, you do need to be home. That a puppy cannot be left alone that long at the age that puppies usually have to go to fosters. So in like that case, like you would have to have an older animal, whether it's an older cat or an older dog, which people need fosters for those animals. Also kittens, if you don't want an older animal, kittens are fairly low maintenance, obviously, to the point where you don't have to be home all day. Like for example, how we have the kitten right now, it's an 8-week old kitten. She's got her own setup. She does not need me at all. Like just because I'm home, I, you know, try and play with her and give her human contact as much as possible, but like it's not needed, obviously. And in situations where I feel like a lot of people think like, oh, well, you know, it's definitely better if they do have someone, 100%, it's better if they have someone who is home all day to hang out with them and play with them and give them contact, whatever. But they'd obviously much rather just be inside in a home being fed and taken care of than outside or, you know, in some crappy condition. So keep that in mind when if you think that like, oh, I can't do it, I'm not home enough or whatever the case may be. And like I said, older animals definitely need fosters. One thing to note about fostering an older dog or cat compared to a kitten and puppy, they do take a lot longer to find someone to adopt them. So most of the animals that are in the, you know, shelters and rescues are grown animals. Like even at the rescue that we go through, They obviously have animals that have been there for quite some time, and that's because nobody can foster them and nobody wants to adopt them, so they live there, and it definitely sucks. So I always say, if you are able to foster or adopt a grown dog or cat, please do, because they do not get anybody. But like I said, keep in mind, if you do foster a older dog or cat, they do take longer to find and a person to adopt them because they are older. There's been people who have been fostering dogs for years before they find someone to adopt them. Obviously with puppies and kittens, it's way easier. Before, when we have like puppies, before they even turn 8 weeks old, we already have many, many applications. So essentially, like, the minute they turn 8 weeks and they get that last round of shots or whatever, we usually have somebody to give them to. So to kind of piggyback off that, I'll talk about the application process for anyone who like wants to know how that works, whether you want to be a foster or someone to adopt. This is all based off the rescue that we go through. Like, I don't know if it's different through other rescues, but our rescue has a Facebook that is public to everybody, and that is where they will post pictures of the animals that are available to adopt with a little snippet of their name, kind of how they are as an animal and everything that you need to know, with a link that you can apply to. Those applications will get sent to the foster parent. So my mom will get a bunch of emails of, you know, people applying, and there's just kind of just a whole questionnaire to fill out. I'm not gonna go through every single question, A, because I don't know them all, and B, I'd be here forever. But it's basically asking things, you know, like where you work, what your schedule is, you know, how many people are in the home, your animals in your home. Also ask some questions about like your discipline tactics. Like, it gives you scenarios like, oh, if you're, you know, if your pet was doing this and it wasn't stopping, what would you do? Or stuff like that, like scenarios to tell us how you would treat your animal. Asks things like if you have a fenced in yard, if your current animals are on like heartworm, obviously asks for your vet's information, just stuff like that, and obviously where you live and everything. And there are some non-negotiables, because I think with every situation there is a little bit of leeway, but the heartworm thing is like most definitely like a non-negotiable. Like, if someone wants to adopt an animal but their current pets are not on heartworm like prevention, we will not give that animal to that family. As well as, obviously, depending on how you answer your questions, believe it or not, there are people who do answer the disciplinary questions in a not great way. So we look at those answers, as well as there are home visits, depending on how your home looks, if it looks well suited. And I don't think there's never been a time where my mom's went to a house and been like, yeah, you can't have an animal. I mean, like, I don't think it's happened, but there is a home visit. And then a fenced in yard. That is not it's not a non-negotiable, but it's a hefty one. There has been a time where one of our fosters, we did give it to a family that did not have a fenced in yard. Everything else checked out. They really wanted this dog. They were a perfect family for it. And there are exceptions to every rule, I will say. It's just, ideally, a fenced in yard is the ideal for most situations. Another thing that I get asked a lot is about like, oh, do you have to pay or anything? You don't have to pay to foster. You don't have to pay for any supplies. Technically, the rescue gives you everything you need. They give you your food, your toys, your bedding, like everything that you would need for your pet. Obviously, my mom does go sometimes and buy things for said foster animal, just because she does and because she likes it. And then as far as the adoption goes, there is a fee, obviously. I can't remember how much it is for Rejoiceful. I think it's definitely like $400 or somewhere along that line. But that covers all of the shots that the animal needed, as well as it covers when you get them fixed at some point. Getting them fixed will be free because that was included in the adoption fee. Something else to just note, because I get this question a lot, is about their names. Obviously, if it is a older animal, the name stays. They know their name 99% of the time. But for kittens and puppies, the rescue will usually name them in litters, and they name them the weirdest, stupidest names. I'm not even gonna lie. They'll name them, like, they'll think of a popular group in the media, and they'll name all of the puppies or kittens that group to kind of categorize them and keep it easy. Like I think one was like the Little Rascals or whatever that movie is, and they named all of the puppies the names from that movie. You are allowed to change them, sort of. So we'll get a puppy and we'll name them whatever we want to name them, and that's how we go by it, and that's fine. But when they do post it on their Facebook, they go by the name that they chose for the whole when they were born type thing, just to keep it all organized. We always tell the adoptive family what we named them, that they obviously do not have to keep that name. No one ever has kept that name. Obviously they are so little that it doesn't matter, but just a couple examples. One of the pairs of puppies we named Silas and Brinkley. Silas is now Coakley and Brinkley is now Nova. And I mean, that's kind of it. I could go on and on about what it's like fostering animals and the whole process and everything. Also, before I end the video, I did forget to mention a thing called foster failure. It's a term to just imply when you fail at fostering and you decide to keep your foster animal. We have done that once. I will insert pictures of him as a puppy, as well as now. Link, he was our foster, and I think we knew we wanted to keep him because every application that came in, we were finding something wrong with it. And to be fair, we weren't getting a lot of great applications, but still, I think we low-key wanted to keep him and we just didn't know it. So we ended up keeping him. Greatest decision we probably ever made. So yeah, it's okay if you are a foster failure. I think everyone probably does it at least once. So yeah, I just kind of wanted to touch base on that we did keep one of our fosters before and adopt him. And now he's Link. But yeah, I could go on and on about what it's like to foster animals and the whole process and about the rescue that we go through, etc., but I would be here forever. So I kind of just wanted to just give a little bit. And obviously, if anyone wants more information, you can always feel free to message me on Instagram or Facebook or whatever. But yeah, that was it. That is all the little bit of information about what it's like to foster animals. And just the whole process and everything. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. If you did, please give it a thumbs up. Subscribe if you have not already, and I will see you guys in my next video. Bye. I do need some energy because I didn't get a lot of sleep last night.